You know, for 4,500 years, the Great Pyramid of Giza has just dominated the landscape. It's a 6-million-ton monument to what humans can achieve. But the question that has always bugged everyone is, how? Seriously, how did a civilization using copper and stone tools create something so massive, so unbelievably perfect, that it stayed the tallest thing on Earth for almost 4,000 years? Today, we're going to tear down the myths and rebuild the real myth.
I mean, really think about that. That's the core challenge, right? We're talking about quarrying, dragging, and then lifting 2.3 million blocks of stone. Some of these blocks weigh as much as a school bus, and they had to get them up to the height of a 40-story building. So forget the aliens, forget the lost technologies. We're going to reconstruct how the ancient Egyptians actually did it, using real archaeology, ancient texts, and even some 21st century physics.
All right, first things first, we have to tackle the biggest myth of them all, the one we've all seen in the movies. Who were the people that actually put in the work to build this thing?
Yeah, that whole image of thousands of slaves being whipped while they haul stones, that comes from the Greek historian Herodotus, who was writing 2,000 years after the pyramid was built. And of course, Hollywood ran with it. But the archaeological truth? It's so much more interesting. These weren't slaves at all. They were a skilled national workforce of Egyptian citizens.
And the proof is just undeniable. Archaeologists found an entire cemetery for the workers right there at Giza. And trust me, you do not give slaves honorable tombs right next to a sacred monument. Inside the pyramid itself, there's hidden graffiti from the work crews with names like the Friends of Khufu Gang. That doesn't sound like slaves. That sounds like a team with real pride. And their diet? Bone analysis shows they ate tons of prime beef, a total luxury. They had expert medical care for their injuries and lived in a planned-out city, not some temporary camp. The picture is crystal clear. These were valued professionals working on a project of national importance.
So the secret to the pyramid's success was really sealed before a single block was even cut. The level of planning here is, and I'm not exaggerating, absolutely mind-blowing.
Okay, first, just try to picture the foundation. They had to level a piece of bedrock that was a staggering 13 acres. That's about 10 football fields.
Now, across that enormous space, get this, the entire base is level to within 2.1 centimeters. That is less than an inch of error across 10 football fields. And that wasn't just for show. It was a structural necessity. You get that wrong and millions of tons of stone will eventually come crashing down.
Their precision was just on another level. The entire pyramid is aligned to true north with a tiny deviation of just 3 arc minutes. That's an accuracy modern crews with all our tech would be proud of. And for them, it had this deep religious meaning. It was all about aligning the pharaoh's soul with the eternal, never-moving stars of the northern sky for his journey into the afterlife.
So how on earth did they do it without a compass? Well, it was brilliant and surprisingly simple. You build a perfectly level, circular wall. Then you watch a single star as it rises in the east and sets in the west, marking both spots on the wall. All you have to do then is find the exact halfway point between those two marks. A line drawn from the center of your circle through that midpoint points directly to true north. Just brilliant. It's a perfect example of their mastery of practical astronomy.
All right, the plan is perfect. The next massive hurdle is logistics. We're basically talking about managing an industrial-scale supply chain to move millions of tons of stone from all over the country.
And they were incredibly strategic about their materials. The bulk of the pyramid, the inner core, was made from limestone that they quarried right there on the Giza Plateau. Super convenient. But for that smooth, gleaming white outer casing, they brought in high-quality Tura limestone from across the Nile. And for the really critical chambers, like the King's Chamber, they used super hard granite that they floated on barges all the way from Aswan, 800 kilometers to the south.
Now, how do we know all this for sure? Well, in 2013, an archaeologist stumbled upon the Diary of Mir. It's a 4,500-year-old logbook from a guy who ran a cargo boat crew. It is the oldest document on papyrus ever found. And in it, Mir writes about picking up blocks of Tura limestone and delivering them to a harbor right at the pyramid's base, a place he called the Horizon of Khufu. This was the smoking gun.
It proved they built canals that brought the Nile right to the construction site.
Okay, so the blocks arrive at this harbor. Now they have to be moved overland on these huge wooden sledges. But this creates a classic physics problem. Anyone who's tried to drag something heavy through dry sand knows it's a nightmare. The friction is immense, and it would take a huge number of people.
And the solution? It was hiding in plain sight for thousands of years, in a 4,000-year-old tomb painting. The painting shows this huge crew hauling a statue on a sledge. But if you look really close at the front, there's one guy pouring liquid onto the sand. For centuries, people just thought, oh, that's just some kind of ceremony.
Turns out, it wasn't ceremonial at all. When modern physicists actually recreated this, they found that this one simple action reduces the pulling force you need by a staggering 50%. I mean, it literally cuts the required effort in half. But how?
The secret ingredient was water. But, and this is key, not too much water. You see, a very specific amount of water creates these tiny capillary bridges between the sand grains. It makes the surface firm, allowing the sledge to just glide over it. Think about that for a second. This incredibly simple, low-tech trick effectively doubled their manpower. It's just a beautiful solution to a massive physics problem.
Okay, so we've gotten the stones to the pyramid's base. We've solved the horizontal puzzle. But now we hit the biggest mystery of all. How in the world did they get them to the top? And this brings us to what's known as the Great Ramp Debate.
For a long time, the two most popular ideas were either a massive straight ramp coming out from the pyramid or a spiral ramp that corkscrewed around the outside. But both of these theories have fatal flaws. A straight ramp would need to be over a mile long and would require almost as much material as the pyramid itself. There's just no evidence for it. And a spiral ramp on the outside? That would cover up the corners, which would make it totally impossible for the surveyors to make sure the sides would meet perfectly at the peak.
And this leads us to the leading theory today, the internal ramp. This idea from architect Jean-Pierre Houdin suggests they used a short, straight external ramp to build the bottom third of the pyramid. But at the same time, they were building another ramp, a spiral one, inside the pyramid as they went. Once the bottom section was done, they dismantled the outside ramp and used those blocks to finish the top two-thirds, hauling them up through the internal ramp.
And there's some really compelling evidence for this. A microgravity scan done way back in the 80s actually found a low-density spiral shape inside the pyramid, right where this ramp would have been. Plus, if you look closely, there's a strange notch high up on the northeast corner that lines up perfectly with where a turning station would need to be to pivot the blocks around the corner. It's an elegant theory. It uses way less material, leaves no trace, and, critically, it keeps the outside clear for those all-important surveyors.
Now, believe it or not, this story is not over. In fact, right now, as we speak, 21st century technology is uncovering secrets that have been sealed away for thousands of years.
Back in 2017, the Scan Pyramids Project did something incredible. They used cosmic ray muons, particles from space, to basically X-ray the pyramid, and they found something shocking, a massive 30-meter-long void, a huge empty space right above the Grand Gallery. We have no idea what it's for.
And then, just last year, in 2023, that same project confirmed another hidden space, a 9-meter-long corridor hidden behind the main entrance. Now, some people think these voids were just to relieve stress on the chambers below, but others point out that that big void is in a perfect spot to have been part of that internal ramp system. The pyramid is still an active dig site, just in a whole new way.
So in the end, the pyramids weren't built by aliens. They weren't built with magic. They were built with brilliant, practical, ingenious solutions, managed by a sophisticated government and powered by the pride of a national workforce. And yet, after 4,500 years of people crawling all over it, we are still finding brand new rooms and hidden hallways. It just proves that this ancient wonder hasn't given up all of its secrets. And it leaves us with one really thrilling question. What are we going to discover next?